Hello and welcome to a special edition of The Big Fight. Why is it a special edition? Because we had recorded a perfectly acceptable and a really interesting episode of The Big Fight yesterday, which was supposed to air out at this moment. And in that particular episode of The Big Fight, what we'd essentially done is looked at strategies in the path to 2019. What is going to be the opposition strategy? What is going to be the BJP strategy? And the net conclusion that we had arrived in The Big Fight is that the BJP is going to be taking Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas and development, and that's going to be the focus. And if that's the focus, then there's no way that the opposition can ever come together. Why did we reach that conclusion? It's because a series of BJP ministers actually said that to us, including on that particular program. We'll play that for you a little later. However, today, this has happened. We've just had Yogi Adityanath, who has been, who's going to be sworn in now as the new Chief Minister of Uttar Pradesh. There you have him, Yogi Adityanath, the man of the moment, the new Chief Minister of Uttar Pradesh. And let's be very blunt about it, a rather controversial choice. Now, he may be popular, but he's also controversial. And over the course of the next 1 hour, we're going to have a number of experts telling us what specifically the election of Yogi Adityanath as the next Chief Minister of Uttar Pradesh means, and what also that means for the strategies that we have going into 2019. All right, so I'm going to start welcoming a series of guests that we have. Mohammad Khan is joining us from the Congress Party. Aarti Jairath is with us as well. Sudhinder Bhadauria is with us, BSP leader. We are about to be joined by Sudhanshu Mittal, Rakesh Sinha. A number of people are going to be joining us, and we will actually, just out of interest, if nothing else, play for you some of what we were going to be showing you today, the statements of various BJP ministers saying there's going to be absolutely no Hindutva, no hard line, nothing. It's only about development. So, and I have to ask all of you whether that strategy has now changed. Mohammad Khan, why don't I come in with you first?
Right.
How do you interpret this particular decision?
My God. Vikramji, I think it's clear that the BJP...
My God, that's your reaction.
Well, I think that's an understatement, considering what the people of UP must be feeling right now, let down and defrauded.
Why are you saying let down and defrauded? They could theoretically say that the people of Uttar Pradesh voted for this 325
So, you remember what the Prime Minister said? You remember what the Prime Minister said shortly after being elected? He said this is a government for everyone, those who voted and those who didn't vote for them as well. And here we see this choice. Does this choice reflect a government for everyone? I don't think it does. Look, Yogi Adityanath Saab's background is known to everyone. Is he a strong on crime candidate? I don't think he is. I think as this debate progresses, examples will be given to the contrary. Is he a unifier? Is he a grand unifier of the diverse population that voted for Modi ji and which Modi ji presents with so much pride? I don't think that's true. I think there are several examples that will be presented across this debate. The BJP, and Vikram sir, you rightly pointed out that up until 24 hours ago, these people would have been talking about development. But this has exposed that claim entirely. It's a hollow claim.
Okay, I want to go across to Rahul Srivastava, who actually, you know, broke this story way before anybody else, and how he actually got the sense of that. And then I want to get Rakesh Sinha, who's joining us. I'll ask him as well. Rahul, this really did take a lot of people by surprise. It took people so much by surprise that when you first were calling in and saying it is going to be Yogi Adityanath, quite frankly, and I'm admitting it on air, I didn't completely believe it. I said, is that really going to be the case? It flies in the face of what a lot of the central BJP leaders are saying. What lies behind this decision?
Vikram, it seems that over the last 7 days, there was a jigsaw puzzle out of which one piece seemed to be missing. And in the evening, it seemed to have fallen in place. I think the earliest traces of when Yogi Adityanath became a big contender after Manoj Sinha, Kesha Prasad Maurya, Rajnath Singh, and several others, their names were doing the rounds. It was yesterday evening when we got the tip-off that there is going to be yet another round of consultation between the BJP top brass, Amit Shah to be specific, and the RSS top brass, which was in Coimbatore for a Pratinidhi Sabha meeting. And what we were told that people like Bhaiyaji Joshi, Dattatreya Hosbole and Krishna Gopal were going to have a con call, a telephonic conference call with Amit Shah. And there are going to be discussion on not one or two or three names, but four names. And the four names were Manoj Sinha, Kesha Prasad Maurya, Yogi Adityanath and Rajnath Singh. Now, that's when it started clicking that perhaps Yogi Adityanath is still in the fray. In the morning, discussions started, and then a special plane was sent to Gorakhpur to get Yogi Adityanath to Delhi. Yogi Adityanath met the Prime Minister, and then there were consultation between Keshav Prasad Maurya, Prime Minister Amit Shah, and others. Now, what we can say is that these are the day events of yesterday night and today. Yogi Adityanath was on the radar of the BJP and the RSS for almost 1.5 years. I remember there was a meeting in Hyderabad of the RSS in which Yogi Adityanath was backed by the RSS. The BJP's ground surveys were talking about Adityanath as being as the most popular man among the BJP and the RSS cadres. But the BJP did not project him during the election. In fact, there was a buzz that Yogi Adityanath is unhappy over the distribution of tickets because he was not being involved in the exercise. Right. But then he was specially called to Lucknow. He was with the BJP president for the manifesto release. Yogi Adityanath actually never went away. The BJP deliberately did not bring Yogi Adityanath forward. It could have brought him forward as the face of the BJP's campaign if he was a suitable candidate, but it didn't. It was part of his strategy, it seems now, that it didn't want to put forward Yogi Adityanath because it was trying to play a narrative which included development and certain strident Hindutva. Yogi Adityanath would have polarized the minority vote in one direction. And that is why eventually the BJP is in sync with what it did during the campaign by talking about development and Kabristan and power to minorities. And it is looking at 2019 election. It's in constant electoral mode in which it is trying to retain the polarization which has happened in UP till the next elections.
All right, Rahul, thanks for joining us for an update of what happened behind the scene. How is it all going to play out? All right, let's now get to our debate here on the big fight. Sudhanshu Mittal joining us from the BJP, Rakesh Sinha joining us from the RSS, Ghanshyam Tiwari is going to be with us in a minute or two from the Samajwadi Party, Surinder Bhadauria is with us also from the Bahujan Samaj Party. Thank you all so much for being with us. We heard Mohammad Khan very, very strongly expressing his views on this. Sudhanshu Mittal, the BJP taking this decision, yes, your core supporters are going to be probably delighted. This is what they were wanting, Yogi Adityanath. Let's have this as a very hardline image. It, to some extent, flies in the face of what the Prime Minister and others have been saying in the week, especially after the UP victory. The Prime Minister saying, let's focus on 2022. I only want to talk about development. Let's build a new India. Let's not get into any things of 125 crore Indians have to be focused upon. The signal sent by having Yogi Adityanath as the Chief Minister of Uttar Pradesh flies in the face of everything that the Prime Minister has been saying for the last week.
Vikramji, I do not know how you conclude these statements you are making just now. Yogi ji has not even taken oath. He has done nothing which will belie Prime Minister's faith that sabka saath, sabka vikas, we have to take everybody together. And as far as these allegations are concerned, when Narin Bhai became the Prime Minister, or even when he became a candidate itself, the same narrative we had heard, which has been squarely and rightly rejected by this nation. So I appeal to you, it is high time, please reject this. This is not true. And it only reflects a mindset which is still, talking 30 years back.
I agree with you. Let's forget this whole secularism issue. Forget that. Let's take that off the table. Let's talk about development. The campaign is over. Tell me, what are the credentials of Mr. Yogi Adityanath that make him fit and capable to administer a state of 20 crore people? Sir, that is our question today. And I doubt that you have a fitting answer for that, sir. Forget secularism. Ho gayi campaign. Khatam ho gaya. Chunav khatam ho gaya, sir.
Sir, can I talk? Let's have a decent, civilized debate. If you are getting into a Bhindi market, I am not interested. Mr. Vikram Chandra, you are the anchor. If you can regulate the debate, fine. I don't want to get into a tutu meme. Okay, I dislike this kind of a narrative which is being enacted here. As far as the credentials of Mr. Yogi are concerned, as far as the narrative about Mr. Yogi Raj's...
Sudhanshu, finish what you're saying.
Mr. Yogi, Yogi ji's suitability is concerned. A 5-time member parliament, who was the youngest member parliament in his first thing, to question his suitability by somebody who has been squarely vanquished, I think it doesn't behove him to even raise these issues. A party with 7 MLAs today talking about the suitability of somebody who has been elected by 325 MLAs. Please, let's have some...
Sir, regardless of the size, we are still in opposition, sir. Right. And regardless of how much you like,
let's
continue to perform that function,
sir. No, you be in the opposition. You be in...
Sir, we are mindful of our responsibility.
I
know you want us to be silent, but we will ask these questions, sir, and you will unfortunately have to answer them, sir.
Sir, can we be decent? I'm not getting...
Mohammed Khan...
Mr. Chandra, can you regulate the debate?
Yes, I'm trying
to. I'm not getting into cross talk.
Can
regulate, fine.
All right, Mohammed Khan, one sec. Sudhanshu ji, one sec. Let me just come back to what you started by saying, that why a question about Yogi Adityanath when he's just taken over and he is still to be sworn in as the Chief Minister of Uttar Pradesh? That's a valid point. You know, it's possible he's going to be a very gentle, very kind, you know, inclusive, taking everyone with him, sort of a Chief Minister. It is possible. The reason why questions are being asked, though, is because of his past track record, not just the various charges that are against him, ranging from attempt to murder, rioting, promoting enmity between different groups. Also, the statements that he himself has made, whether on Shah Rukh Khan or Mother Teresa or, you know, will install idols of Gauri Ganesh in every masjid if I'm given a chance. It's because of his past record that those questions are being asked right now.
Mr. Chandra, let me first talk about the criminality. Please go through the affidavit and you'll discover that not one charge has been framed against him till date. In fact, only three of the cases have even been taken cognizance of by the court. Rest cases have not even been taken cognizance of. So as far as all that is concerned is here, the proof of the pudding is in its eating. 2.5 years down the line, has the NDA government shown even one, given you one instance, where they have differentiated on the grounds of religion? No. See, the entire theory you have to understand. It is justice for all, appeasement to none. You can hold a government accountable if this maxim is being violated. If this is what we are following,
okay.
I don't think...
So we have to hope... So Sudhanshu ji...
the legislation has started.
Yeah, so Sudhanshu ji, in essence what you are saying, and let's hope what you are saying is correct, by the way, I sincerely, frankly and completely do hope that what you're saying is correct and that Yogi Adityanath as the Chief Minister of Uttar Pradesh will not follow the principles that he has sometimes stated as Yogi Adityanath on the campaign trail or when being a Pracharak or when roaming around and making the statements. Let's hope he will not follow that. And you're right, we should give him the benefit of the doubt to see whether he will do it or not. Okay, Rakesh Chenna, let me just get you in on that point.
Yeah.
This particular decision, the fact that it wasn't Keshav Prasad Maurya, as many were thinking, or even Rajnath Singh, Manoj Sinha, any of them, and it became Yogi Adityanath, we were hearing from Rahul about those conversations that have been taking place with the RSS. Is this an RSS decision?
No, I think BJP is a party which is capable to take decision. Wherever there is a need for consultation, the RSS, it goes for consultation. But my point is that there are certain sections in India, it includes both intellectuals and also media persons, they are habitual to demonize the Hindutva leaders. You begin with Savarkar ji, Sri Guruji Golwalkar, Sri Mohan Bhagwat ji, Narendra Modi ji, Amit Shah, and now Yogi Adityanath. When Amit Shah was elevated as the party president, you know how he was demonized. When Narendra Modi was as the prime ministerial candidate, the entire section of media and intellectuals demonized him.
Your leaders feel compelled to jump
in. You are not the anchor.
I have to correct you.
You are not the anchor. Let me complete.
History does not work. Let me complete. I am responding
to Bikram Chandra. Bikram Chandra, kindly ask him not to
speak. I am.
Bikram Chandra ji, kindly ask him to complete my.
Mr. Khan, one at a time.
Bikram Chandra ji, kindly ask him to complete my.
I already asked him. Now, Rakesh.
Let me complete. Yogi Adityanath is a member of parliament. You go to his constituency. Is there any discrimination with the minority community? You go to the entire history of the RSS, whether it's a natural calamity or something else. We have treated every citizen equal. It is the media which gives, a certain section of media which gives give a dog bad name and then hang.
It's always so the media's fault. Yes, I know it's always the media's fault.
As a popular leader who has a bigger constituency in Uttar Pradesh,
Right.
Bigger constituency in Uttar Pradesh, and I think there would be inclusive development in Uttar Pradesh.
Okay.
Bikram Chandra, I am finishing.
And as I said to Surinder Bhatoria, you know, I certainly hope what you're saying is correct.
Has glorified.
Finish, Rakesh, what you're saying.
Politics of magnetism has glorified the Suleiman Seth, who was in parliament, Owaisi, who is in parliament, but you are demonizing Yogi Adityanath, who has no criminal record.
Okay, I'm going to ask for this particular dialogue. I'm going to give you a chance to respond, Mohammed Khan, in a second. As soon as I get Surinder Bhatoria in, then I'm going to give you a chance to respond to that. Mr. Bhatoria, your take on what's just happened in UP.
Well, I think the election of Yogi Adityanath presents the true picture of Bharatiya Janata Party. They all the time were talking about Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas, but they had in their heart love jihad, they had in their heart ghar ki vapsi, they had in their heart what Sadhvi Niranjan Jyoti had also said. So therefore, this is now out in the open. Even during the course of elections, they talked this language of Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas, but the real agenda came out much later when they talked about Kabristan and Shamshan. So therefore, now the nation knows very clearly where the BJP stands and where the rest of the nation stands. The spirit of Indian constitution of tolerance is being defied. That is what we are seeing today. It is out in the open. And let me say this.
Okay.
In days to come, we will certainly see very tough times for those people who have firm faith in the Constitution of India and have faith in the tolerance, which has been an age-old tradition,
tough
not only
time,
of
you are saying,
Pradesh, but of this country.
Hang on. You're making a very strong statement there. You're saying a tough time for people who believe in the Constitution. That's what we're heading for. Did you just say that, Mr. Bhatoria?
Yes, they are saying that they will make the Ramka Mandir, whatever be the decision of the Supreme Court.
Mr. Mittal and Rakesh, it's a strong allegation that has been made because it goes beyond polarization. Hang on.
Your party has given 97 Muslims as a candidate in Uttar
Rakesh,
Pradesh.
The elections are over. Elections are over. Elections are over. Can I just get Aarti in? I want to talk about strategy running to 2019. I'm not interested in what happened in these elections at this point now. Elections are over. BJP has won. Yogi Adityanath is the chief minister. Those are all facts. Now let's try and understand and interpret what this means going forward from here. Aarti,
I think the Ram Mandir is very much the top priority of the agenda of this government. If you remember, during the day the results were coming out, we talked, a lot of BJP leaders said that, yes, Ram Mandir and all that, but you know, we have promised that we will do it through either the constitutional route, that is through the court, or by getting a consensus between communities to build the Ram Mandir. I don't see how Yogi Adityanath can be entrusted with the task of building a consensus between Hindus and Muslims for the construction of a Ram Mandir. So I see this Ram Mandir becoming a very contentious issue in the coming days. And it is very much, you know, Vikram, you know, the BJP had always said that we don't have a majority government at the center, we don't have a majority government in UP, and therefore we can't touch the Ram Mandir. Now they have both.
Okay.
So, you know,
so can I ask you a question? Okay, now all of you, I'm just wanting to shift the focus. So let me come back. So can we all please come back to what actually we had recorded on the Big Fight to be aired out today, which was on strategies running into 2019? Because, Sudhanshu, I'm just going to start by asking you this question.
No, but can I just
point out? One second. I'm just moving on a bit. The issue is, what is going to be the path that either the BJP or the opposition going to take after Uttar Pradesh in the run-up to 2019? And frankly, in my assessment, two possible paths that the BJP could have taken. One path was this development on both the paths, yes, but one would have been slightly softer, more moderate, more inclusive, Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas, just keep focusing on that, don't allow anything else to come up and go to 2019 on that. Also, that route doesn't give the opposition anything to unite against. Path two was development, yes, but together with a certain amount of Hindutva, hard Hindutva, certain amount of authoritarianism, make sure that, you know, keep attacking the press, doing things like that. That's the second path. Now, as of yesterday, the conclusion actually in the big fight was that the BJP is going to follow the first path. Now, I'm not 100% sure anymore. So let me ask you, Sudhanshu Mittal, two possible paths for the BJP running to 2019. Which of these two paths do you think the party is going to follow?